We have so many bells, gongs, and singing bowls around here. I'm having them all. I don't know which one to strike first. So you'll have to go along with me. It's good to be back. So the theme for today's service is summer travel and summer enjoyments. On the support page I mentioned, summer is a good time to take a few days off, relax, reflect, drink cold lemonade, and explore travel adventures. It's a way to restore our inner and outer self. So two highlights of the summer for me, have been our trip to Beaverbrook Art Gallery and our two-week vacation that Linda and I took to Newfoundland and Nova Scotia. So our prelude this morning reflects that rambling nature that many of us are really spread out on trips, travel plans. So this is by Don Williams, one of my favorite country artist. And I know Mary also loves Don Williams. And I think this is one of the only instrumentals I've come across on his albums. And it's titled Rambling.
Thank you.
sometimes hectic lives a summer break. We rest in this present moment. We are awake. We are alert. We are alive.
Nicole, you are the closest person to the chalice this morning. Would you please help us out? Light our chalice for us.
It's her first time. The radiant nature of our mind is like a small flame burning in a chalice. Its size does not matter. Large or small flame, they are both light. Be aware of your own light. It is right here. It has never been absent. Now is the time to simply notice that it's shining. Let it shine.
So opening words this morning continue traveling theme. So this is from poet Carl Sandburg, poet and lover of American life and travels. So this poem was written during one of his stays in New York City. It's a prayer. Bless thee, O Lord, for the living arc of the sky over me this morning. Bless thee, O Lord, for the companionship of night mist far above the skyscraper peaks I saw when I woke once during the night. Bless thee, O Lord, for the miracle of light to my eyes and the mystery of it ever changing. Bless thee, O Lord, for the laws you have ordained, holding fast these tall oblongs of stone and steel, holding fast the planet in its course and the farthest beyond the cycle of the sun. Bless all of us, O Lord. Amen.
We're going to sing number 188. And this is going to be interesting. It's done in a round. And so we have two sections. Even though it's more people, call this side A, side B. I'm going to sing with side B, okay? Not that it helps out a whole lot. Karen, you can read side A. Amish Brown's going to work. We're going to sing it together once. And then, this side of the church, we'll start in at group two, or group B. You'll see the number two in the music. That's when they hit number two, we start singing the song. Just follow me.
Okay.
Sing loud. Okay. We're going to stand. I'll give you a chord.
Confirm that humankind and nature were part of an eternal, everlasting, never-ending process. And Steve went on to say that he illustrated this best in his famous painting, Santiago del Pond. And that was one of the driving reasons why many of us went to Fredericton, was to see Dali's work in person. What's going to come up in both of these presentations is the limitation of photography and media to capture an in-person experience of place, location, sensation, the visual, and the existential encounter with the content. And Linda and I, people I ran into, other photographers, as we were going through Newfoundland and the Beaverbrook, we were all taking photographs and realizing when I got back to look at it on the phone and the computer, that it was not going to capture that experience. But it's a good hint. You get a bit of a preview or a teaser of what it is like. So that's what we're doing in this limited set in the next 2 weeks of this PowerPoint and the slides. And this isn't even a very large screen, okay, I'm aware of. There may be some glare from the spotlight. So feel free to get up and move around if you need to get closer or a better glimpse. And there is discussion of future services in the sanctuary. May require is a larger screen to do what you want to do. More on that later. So, this first slide is a photograph of a new edition of the Beaverbrook Gallery by the McCain family. I'm not even sure what year it opened with this new wing. So this would be a glimpse of it. And this would be the front entrance to the, you know, the white, you know, simplicity and the large space as you enter it, and the, some people said, wasted space of the lobby and emptiness of not even a lot of art on the wall, on a huge front lobby. Gift shop to the far left. Cafe to the far right, which several of us explored as part of the experience. So this, you'll see, we're in the entrance, and the whole murals, bright colors in contrast to the stark white of the building as you enter. And I try to get as many of the 24 DUs in these photographs as possible. Some are background shots, and I'll give all the names of who was there later in the presentation. But you'll see us as we're looking around before the tour. We had a guided tour that Steve Kinney set up for us. There was too much to look at as the tour went on. And so many of us would focus on whatever caught our eye.
Could you use the
mics? So this is a close-up of that same wall, which made a big photo op for some of our members. Adrian on the trip. And I have 70 slides here, so they're going to move quickly. I want to leave time for people who went to add a few comments to their experience with Beaverbrook. So this is one of the first pieces of art. By Wanda Coop, a Canadian artist born in 1951. This is Emily Carr's painting of an Indian family totem pole from 1912. And right beside it was an adaptation. You watch closely. It's the same piece. This is by Sonny Ace, a Canadian from 1975. It's a digital intervention of Emily Carr painting that we just saw, Kate Munch, Indian Family, Totem Pole, 1912. And it's a juxtaposition of a UFO, modern art over the traditional Indian totem. And each one of these paintings has, you know, detailed write-ups of the artist and a little story behind each painting. What I enjoyed about sections of the Beaverbrook were the contemporary art sections. The traditional art, physical art, and this made a great backdrop for some photo shoots of members of the group who I think you will recognize.
Even the windows
You'll notice a few windows in the background. There's just the most people on. This is some of the physical art. It was a huge wooden carved concentric wheels. So I just took an example of a few of these. And it's spread out on the floor. I'm not sure what it was made of. Someone else who went may have known. It seems like a plaster, almost like a seashell and contours on the floor. So you couldn't touch it or anything in the Beaver Brook. You would get, you want it so close to see it, or almost touch it. And to show this restraint, just for visual. This is one of the large tapestries on the wall, and you can see a few of you use Deb Frazier, her partner Jim, Babak, Christoph, Joshua doing some kind of explanation with his arms to Delinda. And zooming in, here Christoph almost looks like he's part of the tapestry. This was a painting by Tim Okamura, painted in 2019 of Willie O'Ree, who was the first black player to play in the NHL for Boston Bruins, I might say, in 1957, breaking the color barrier. And more hockey theme, this is the great Wayne Gretzky. Several Andy Warhol paintings, which I was not aware of, are also the Beaver Brook. And this is Wayne Gretzky. More of our new group walking around. I liked the context of the windows looking outside. I was looking around at our UUs, gazing at art, oftentimes not speaking or not saying, and some of us were, rapid conversations going on, or interpretations of, what do you see here, what do you think of that? But so much of the time was just that interior reflection, and whatever that process was going on against part of that, can't quite pin that down or even put it in words. And here's a section going into the Dolly, the gallery. And this is a painting that Stephen featured in his talk, Santiago. And one thing Steve mentioned in his lecture was oftentimes folks will go in, it's an almost 14 foot tall piece of artwork on the canvas. So to get an angle, an interesting 3D effect is to lay on the floor under the dolly. So you will see several of you used. Corbin is on the right, Dan is in the middle, and David Dauphine on the left. And that's our tour guide. So I was curious, was that unusual for tour groups to come in and lay on the floor? And apparently it is not. It is common. So I'm trying to get this shot laying on the floor, give you a little feel for what it looks like from the floor level. And I believe Christoph took this shot as we are gazing up at the dog. And were you the camera person on this one, Dan? Okay. So we've been trading photographs, you know, ever since this trip, getting different takes, who took photographs that day, getting as many of those as we could into the support page, just to get different glimpses of photos. This is a close-up of the dolly, the lotus flower, or flower petal in the middle of the atomic explosion under the course. And this is a close-up of Dominic's wife, who often appears as a viewer, almost like a Virgin Mary or Mona Lisa, gazing at the work. He's in the bottom right-hand corner. This is a piece, Les Deux Plages, which is Two Beaches, painted by Clarence Gagnon in 1909. And I included a little bit of information in the support page this week about that painting. It was a refreshing summer take. And this is Joseph Mallord William Turner's piece, a British artist, titled The Fountain of Indolence from 1834, which is, again, one of their featured pieces of art at the Louvre. This was one of my favorites, and I've been using it in the support page from our Newfoundland trip, Head in the Wind by Miller Brittain, Canadian. This is painted in 1963. Eyes wide open, wind blowing through the hair, and capturing more of that space, content, design, creativity. This is by Mary Pratt, who was one of the favorite artists of Steve Kinney. I went to the same school, St. Albans, where Steve was a student. This is titled Cold Cream from 1983. And I just liked the design on this by, I can't even pronounce his name, Hermanette Julie Chazon, Canadian artist. And I zoomed in on the flowers, which particularly caught my eye. Just a few more glimpses of the beautiful gallery space. And this piece of art titled A Fish Dreaming. And you can look inside the little window and see a fish on a bed. And the dream is the images around the piece of pottery of mermaids swimming. And here's a picture a couple of you used, taking a peek into the window of the fish dreaming. Picture of Steve. We orchestrated a trip for us. And then someone taking a picture of me, taking a picture of Steve. Do you recognize me, Steve? Different sandals than today, I might say.
Same shorts.
Same shorts, different sandals. Oh, and here's that skylight shot many of us posed in. As Deb and Jim, Linda and Dave. Someone taking a picture of Linda and Dave, looking at the picture they just took of Linda and Dave. Great place for families to go and spend the day exploring. Something for everyone at the beach. Just relaxing after logging a lot of. A lot of pacing and footsteps in the view of work. And as Diane, pink sweater, Max partner, who is also there, and Marion, also in the chair relaxing. And then we all went for lunch right down the street at Isaac's Way. And the art on the walls at the cafe were just as amazing as the Beaverbrook itself. And this is one of their carvings. Several of us posed at photographs. And this is the only group photo I was able to come up with. We didn't pose. We should have somewhere in the lobby. The closest thing I was eating in Isaac's Way, there's 24 of us around the table. And I'm going to work left to right. Steve Kinney, Linda Rowe, Randy Bradbury, Ira, Diane, Diane Mack.
Dan.
Dan. Kristoff. David Dauphiné. Lee. Cricket.
Corbin.
Corbin. Joshua. Jess. Teddy. Martha Stewart. Jim. Deborah Frazier. Adrian. Marion. And myself
as a photographer on the faculty workshop. So that is a speed trip here at Beaverbrook. A few photos captured from the day. Going with a group was an amazing experience. Going alone or with one or two people, but to go and get a taste of other people's adventures and as a group, and share a meal, and directions. We haven't done a field trip that size in years because of logistics and all that's involved. And Park Lab was well documented, and I wanted to spend a little service time during the summer to capture a bit of that experience. So, anyone would like to share or comment or some Q&A? We've got a few minutes that we can take for the end of the service.
That was very well put together for us to put it up. He said that presentation was very well put together for us who did not know.
And this just gives people a taste. It cannot capture that experience.
No.
Again, a guard came up and had to tell me to back off on a close. I was getting my camera to the art. So Bill, you're going to say.
I'm surprised they allowed you to take photographs of the paintings, because some of the museums you were in, they will not allow that.
No flash photography, so they didn't mind the cell phone. They encouraged it, which was good. Be able to share something like this.
I'm thinking Chicago.
Okay, yeah. So their policy may have been lenient, and we appreciated that.
The security guard was watching our group, though.
He followed
us. For sure.
Oh yeah, we had little kids, curious people. All the posing around the art. I didn't share some of the more creative poses.
Yeah.
But the security guard followed us.
The whole time. Yeah.
Adrian, glad you walked in. You were on the screen several times.
Mm-hmm. It's really worth the trip to see the artwork. I mean, it's amazing pieces that people have been cherishing for many, many years. So it's definitely worth the trip. It's beautiful.
Yeah, send that one to me. Yeah, there is something for everyone. Artistic taste from children. You're an artist yourself, so you're looking at it with that approach.
There's just a wide, diverse range of different types of art, which is interesting, you know? Gives you inspiration.
And having Roger Morin's art here this summer, you know, during July 4th, Midnight Madness, featuring his work, and Steve's lecture, you know, we've pivoted and drawn several different aspects from the presentation of art, food, music, and doing it as a community post-COVID and through customs. We all got through.
Luckily.
Incident.
Yeah.
Minimal paperwork. Anything else?
I'm a huge supporter of artists. I just think they bring so much life to the community. And if you don't visit museums, or you just, it hasn't been on your radar, or even just small galleries, please go. Artists tell such wonderful stories, and they need our support. And not just the ones that are in galleries, but living artists, people you know, really support them.
It was mentioned about the galleries
in the town. And that was our focus, just that one gallery. And there were galleries again in St. John's, you know, that we wanted to get to on rainy days, but we might have some rainy days. We got photographs of the outside of the museum and some of the churches in St. John's. There's not enough time to explore. And it's transformative just to stand or to lay down in front of a piece of art, to get so close you could almost touch it. It's transformative. And that's what I'm trying to share in today's service, is that aspect, to support artists, but also the effect that we carry it with us, not just on our phones, the images, but to have that experience and to share it with someone who was right there with you. Totally different experience. Mm-hmm. We had 24 different versions of that beautiful trip. And you can't write it all down. So, this was a small step to do so. We extinguish the chalice for today, but the light that is within us and around us does not go out. We carry it with us, the light of compassion, tolerance, and a new vision for the better world. Peace and loving ways to you all.
We want to thank everybody for tuning in today. If you'd like to show your support, please hit the like button. Subscribe to our channel if you're not already subscribed, and help us out by sharing this message by clicking the share button. If you'd like to make a monetary donation to UU Church Holton, there is a link to our online donations in the video description down below. And again, thank you so much, and have a blessed day.